Thanks a lot for the introduction. Welcome, everybody. This is a talk of work in progress. We are trying to use Erlang for automatic testing of web services. So I will report whatever we have done so far and the things that we have in the pipeline. This is how my talk will go. I will start with a very brief overview of what property-based testing is, and I will give a short demo using Proper for those that have not seen it, so that you can understand the rest of the talk. Then I will talk a bit about how traditional testing of web services happens, and I will try to describe how I think that testing of web services has to happen using Erlang. We are building a tool based on Proper, of course, XMerl and Yoz, which are things that you can find in the Erlang tool library, I guess. And then I will show how we can use this to do fully automatic response testing of web services. And I will give a demo on this, which will be the main part of the talk. And then I will show a brief demo of how you can extend this fully automatic way of doing response testing of web services to do property-based testing of web services. And I will again do a short demo there and end up with some ideas of future work, if time permits. So the idea of property-based testing is to express the properties of a program using some input-output relations that the program should satisfy. So the user expresses just properties that the program should satisfy, and then there is typically an automatic tool that tries to find counterexamples for this property. And it does that by automatically generating progressively more involved random test cases. And provided you generate enough test cases, either you find a test case for which the property does not hold, in which case you have found a bug either in your program or in the property that you expressed, or you pass a sufficiently number of different test cases, and then you gain a bit more confidence that your program is correct, or at least it satisfies the properties that you think it should satisfy. You don't, of course, have a proof that your program is correct, but at least you have a good confidence that it's doing something reasonable for many cases. Now, this typically happens based on a general description of the structure of the tests. So typically, in most property-based testing tools, the programmer is responsible for describing how the test inputs should look like. So that's the general idea of property-based testing. Probably you have heard it before. In the last 1.5 years, we have been building a property-based testing tool for Erlang called Proper. It's a tool that is freely available as open source out there. You can get it from this URL. property.softlab.ntua.gr, and it provides support for writing properties and test case generators. It has components for concurrent and parallel testing, both based on a state machine and finite state machine. And the salient feature is that it has a full integration of with a language of types and functional specifications of Erlang. And because of that, generators often come for free. So you don't have to write generators, because if you have the types, the tool knows exactly how to do this automatically. So for those that have not seen how Proper looks like, you typically write tests that look like this one, property tests that look like this one. You write your module with the properties. You have to include a header file that does most of the magic. And then you write your properties. And properties are functions that start with a prop. And then the tool knows automatically that these are properties and can test them for a number of times. And typically the properties are, look like this one. They have typically a for all. So what this property says is that for all terms, if you do term to binary and binary to term, this is supposed to give you the same term back. So I think this is a property that one would expect from the two built-in functions, term to binary and binary to term in Erlang. And indeed, we can actually then compile this program and run it with calling the tool on this simple property, and it runs for the default number of tests, which is 100, and it passes 100 tests. So we are a bit happier than that the program does what it's supposed to do. Okay, so this is known stuff. What's a bit more interesting for proper is that you can write generators using the language of types of generators that it you have like that. So this is another property that says that for all messages which are either binaries or lists of ASCII or ASCII characters, then if you encode and decode the message using the Base64 module of Erlang OTP, you get essentially back the same message. If it's a binary, it's the same message. If it's a list, then decode always returns a binary. So I didn't design this interface, but basically that's what it does. And you can run this again for 100 tests or even more if you want, and it will actually satisfy, it will not find any counterexample to this property. Now, why am I showing you this? Is that what this is what you would have to write if you didn't have types and specs in your program. Proper has a magic way of actually taking a type declaration that you might have in somewhere in your program and turning that automatically into a generator. So you don't really need to write all these generators yourself, provided that you have annotated your Erlang program with types. So this is all stuff that I have presented before, so I'll go a bit fast on this. You can download the tool and play with these examples. I will show you another example that's a very well-known one in the area, or actually in tutorials and talks. And I will show it because I will use it afterwards as a web service. And I have to show you this in Erlang so that I show you then the analogous thing as a web service. So this is an implementation of a list delete function. And it does these things. It calls, if we want to delete an X from a list L, we call an auxiliary function with an accumulator, and we do the deletion with an accumulator. And what we can do here is we can write a property that we might want to our function to satisfy. So this is the property, and it says that for all pairs of X's and L's, where X is an integer and L is a list of integer, if you delete the X from L, then X is not a member of this list anymore. So this is something that you would like for a one delete function to hold a property. Let's see in a demo whether this holds for this delete implementation. So I will do the demo right now, I guess. This one. Oops. I can take. So I load my simple, I compile my simple props module, which has this property, And then I call proper quick check. On the simple props, and I called it prop delete. Oops. And this property fails after 32 tests. It has found element X and a list of integers that contain this X, but they contain it twice. This is an implementation that does not recursively delete things after it has found the first element. So there is a discrepancy there, either in the implementation of the delete function or in the property that we wrote. So one of these two, these things don't match. Perhaps the property is the one to blame. Perhaps the implementation is the one to blame. What the tool also does, notice here that it shrinks this test case to something smaller. It started with a list of, I don't know how many there were, 10, say, elements, and it has shrunk it to a much smaller list that shows exactly what the problem, where the problem is. It's the minimal list that shows the problem, that it has, it's a list with two elements, they are identical, and only one of them is deleted by this delete function. So presumably the programmer can understand the reason why the property is failing much simpler in this simpler example test case than the complicated big one that has tried. So let me continue here. So this is what it does. It shrinks. The previous time I tried this, it failed after 42 tests, and I found it cute, so I put it there for you to see. So the same thing happens with improper with recursive types. Suppose that you can have not a list, which is a built-in type in most property-based testing tools, but some other user-defined type. And here is a relatively complicated one, which shows a binary tree, which is also parameterized by a type parameter. We can write the same property for a function that deletes an element from a tree of elements of that type, and we expect back a tree of that type. So this is the auxiliary join function that we have to write in the case where we delete. So we can again write a property delete for this type of elements. We can just write it like that. We don't have to write anything complicated for a generator for trees. The tool knows exactly how to generate automatically trees, given the type specification, and not only knows how to generate trees, but it also knows how to shrink trees, and you can see it here. I will not show it as a demo. You can believe me that the tool does that. After 24 tests, it has found an example of deleting something from a random tree, and it has shrunk this to the minimum tree that shows what the where the problem is. Okay? Now, notice that this has happened automagically. We just didn't have to write anything complicated for the generator. We just used here in this tree, the tool knows how to search for types around it and generate proper generators for them and do the shrinking automatically. Okay, so this is where we are. But this talk is not about property-based testing in general, it's about property-based testing of web services. So I will start now talking about testing of web services. So in principle, it's very similar to other forms of software testing. So what happens in web services, in testing of web services? We need a way to acquire a valid input. We need a way of invoking an operation for the web service. The web service probably will do its service and give us some output, and then we need to examine this output and declare whether the output is correct or not. So the problem with this is that it's very much, it's a difficult operation because this, there are very few automatic ways that this happens. So typically it's the user that has to write how to acquire valid inputs. They have to write some typically complicated programs that generate valid inputs. And these valid inputs have to follow some specification. And I will use WSDL as the specification of web services here. The tool currently only handles WSDL, but it's in principle extended, can be extended to other specification languages if people want them. So then the automatic way is to just invoke these operations. The difficult part is to how to generate valid inputs. Then we can use some existing framework that knows how to communicate with a web service, for example, Yoast, and invoke these operations automatically. But then the last part is, again, user-based. The user has to check whether the output that they get back from the web service is correct according to their expectations or to the specification of the web service. So we wanted to make this more automatic. So this is what we have done so far. We do proper testing of web services, and it's mostly automatic and goes as follows. Unsurprisingly, we need a way to acquire valid input. We need a way to invoke the operations, and we need a way to examine this input. Okay, nothing much so far. What the tool comes and does is that it does automatic generation of valid inputs. It knows exactly how to read the WSDL specification. It knows exactly how to generate valid inputs from that, and uses the technology in proper to automatically generate more and more complex valid inputs for the web service. Again, the second part is not surprising, that it happens automatically because you could do it automatically in traditional testing. We use Yoast to invoke these operations. And then we need to examine this input somehow. And there it depends on what sort of testing you want to do. If you want to do just response testing, my web service handles all valid inputs, we have an automatic way of doing that. We don't, the user doesn't really need to do anything. If we, so for what we call response testing, this is full, the tool is fully automatic. If you want to do something more than that, like write some complicated properties, and check that these complicated properties hold, well, you have to write the properties. The tool cannot figure out properties on its own. So, but we are going to see that it's very, very simple to actually extend the already given, the already automatically generated infrastructure for response testing to extend them to actually write properties for the tool. So, here's how the high-level view of what we have done looks like. At the one end, we have the user. And at the other end, we have the web service. And the web service is supposed to have currently a WSDL specification of this web service. So the user just says go, nothing really more than that. And it has to write the URI of this web service. You just have to give a URI. So there is a get URI request by the tool. This brings back the WSDL specification. And this WSDL specification is split into two parts. It's split into the types that the WSDL specification contains and the operations. The types get passed to XMerl, and XMerl knows how to parse these types and gives back a parsed form of the types that exist in the WSDL. And then the sparse form is fed into proper. And proper then knows automatically how to generate valid inputs for these services based on the types that they specify. Now, the WSDL doesn't contain only types, it also contains operations that the web service supports. And these operations are fed into YOS. So, proper generates now data based on these types. And the YOS writes to the test file some information about the operations that they are supported by the web service. And then this test file, together with the data, they are fed back to YOS, and YOS sends SOAP tests to the web service and gets back the responses. And the responses, they get back fed into proper to check whether for all the tests that proper has automatically generated, we got back responses that make sense, that are valid, you know, that don't break the web service. So this is totally automatic, and this is the response testing part. If the user wants to do more than that, do property-based testing, they have to go and edit the test file that has been automatically generated and write just the properties. All the rest is there for the user. Sounds like magic, so let's see this in action, actually. Before that, I will just describe a bit about WSDL. Actually, I don't know much about WSDL, so perhaps there are people in the audience that know more about WSDL than I do, so excuse me if I say something that is not totally, that is totally wrong. So a WSDL specification contains all the necessary information to evoke an operation. It contains information about ports that will be used, bindings, messages, parts, and most importantly for us, it contains the types that the web service is supposed to handle. And these types have information, they are part of a types XML tag, and they have simple primitive types like integers, long strings, booleans, and so on, the ones that you would expect. They have aggregates like lists and unions, and they have complex types like sequence, choice, and so on. The most frequent one is the sequence complex type, and they also contain types that describe enumerations. So the tool knows exactly the semantics of these things and has an automatic way of transforming these types into types that the Erlang language has, and then proper has a way of translating these types that the Erlang language has into generators and shrinkers automatically. So the WSDL specifications look like this. Let's see them because you cannot really expect to be reading this stuff. I will just focus on various parts of it. There is the cookings simple type, which has this S colon restriction base equals S colon string, which makes a restriction of the primitive type string and says that the base is a string. It has enumeration types, which have values and adds values to the enumeration. There is another complex type declared there. There were two. There is the change cooking unit complex type, which is a sequence, and it's a sequence of the nested elements of this thing. And these elements are things that they will have a value of type double that appears exactly once. This min occurs and max occurs says how many times this value has to occur. So since the min is one and the max is one, the value has to occur exactly once in this case. There are examples where you can have min occurs one and max occurs unbounded or something like that, I think. And then it says that can be a list of as many elements as you want. So we need a way also to invoke the web services with YOS. And this can happen with the SOAP library of yours. It contains a function called call, which you give it a URI of a WSDL web specification. You give it an operation that you want to invoke or to call, and you give it an, the arguments. And the arguments actually is the problematic part here. You have to, they might become really, really complex when you want to call a specific operation. And yours, for reasons that I don't really know, needs most of the arguments to be converted to strings, but not all. It has some strange ways of doing that. Perhaps some yours developer can tell me why, but anyway, the tool handles all these things. Actually, if you try to do this by hand, I'm sure that if you have a complex WSDL specification or a large one, writing the input by hand will be very error-prone. You will not be able to actually make proper generators for these things. Okay. So, how do we automatically create generators? We need to parse somehow the WSDL specification, extract all the type information in the way that I showed in the figure before, break the types into primitives, handle all the YOS string conversions, output your YOS record as an HRL file, and output proper generators. I will show you this in a demo. So the tool does all that automatically. You don't need to write anything but just go. Okay? So given the previous example that I showed, the cooking unit, the tool automatically generates all this code, which looks hairy and terrible. But what this code does, it has a generator for the change cooking unit type, which is a complex let expression given three other generators that the tool also automatically generates, given what the WSDL description has. So this is all automatically generated. You don't need to write this or understand this at all. If you did not want to, if you want to do it by hand, you would have to write something analogous and even hairier because you would not even have the language of property-based testing tools. So we can all use all that to do automatic response testing. And without doing anything, really. Just because the tool knows that when another error occurs, we get back a SOAP fault message. We can just recognize the SOAP fault message and say that, hey, your web service doesn't handle input like that. Because you have written some types and your operations don't handle all the types of the input. Imagine doing that by hand. You would not be able to find all these inputs. And we can conservatively accept any other response. So without really knowing what the response are, we can do automatic testing of whether we get some response back. Okay? In this case, the property creation is fully automatic. So let's see this as a demo. In this part here, what I will do is I will compile a file called demo. You don't need to see this, actually. You will need to see some other one. So what this demo does, it just brings up a web service that I have written. So you just need to see that it says yours listening to that port there for virtual servers, okay? And this has brought up a web service that I have written based on a WSDL specification. I will show you how it looks. Uh, So the WSDL looks like this. It has various weird stuff. This is the delete example, and this is what you would have to write in WSDL for the delete example. There are easier ways of generating this. I've done it with some tools. But it's hairy stuff. There is also an XSD thingy here. Which has this specification. The interesting part are these two lines in the sequence there under complex type. And this list is a list of integers. It can have length from 1 to unbounded. And the element is an x, which is an integer. And just to show you that I'm not cheating, I put them the other way around. The list first and the element second, while in the implementation that I've done, in the example I showed in Erlang, it was the other way around. So this is a different one. I'm not using the same example that I showed before. So for convenience, I have my web service implemented in Erlang here. But this is actually not interesting and not something that the tool cares about. It doesn't really matter if you are using Erlang, JavaScript, your favorite language to write your web service in. The tool is agnostic of that and can handle all the languages that you have. The choice of language does not matter. So, and this is what you will have to look here. So let me start it again, and I have to cheat. All I need to write is this line. Proper WS, which is the web service part of the web service testing part of Proper, generate under a file. I have to give it a file name. It can be any file that I want. And the file that it's the file where the WSDL specification is. It could be a URI, and a file that it wants it will generate all the tests under. That's all. Now, what this has done is has automatically generated this proper WS my delete file. You can see that has changed. It has automatically generated now. And it looks like this. This is automatically generated code. It has the generators for lists. It has generators for integers, because the integers in WSDL are not big nums. They are in specific ranges. It has a generator for the delete, which has a list and an element. There are generators here for list, generate delete L list and generate delete LX for the list and the element. It has stuff automatically to know how to call the delete. And the property here I can show in the the slide so that you see it in bigger font. What this property says that for all change cooking units, if I call now, this is not the one. This is the property, sorry. For the list delete, we need to generate delete arguments and pass them with call delete and get back some response. If we get the response that says that there has been a fault, then the property is false. Otherwise, no matter what the response is, if it's not a false, the property holds. This property holds, which is just we got a valid response. Okay? We got a response back that made sense. My mouse does not collaborate. So what I can do now is I can compile this file that has been generated. This file also has an associated header file that has all the records. It compiles. Let me copy it and paste it rather than writing it because my typing is terrible. Oh, come on. And it has fed the web server with 100 different combinations of list delete calls, and the web server didn't ever send a fault, a SOAP fault. So it looks like it's working. Let's call it, do it again. Oops. It's not working, really. This is actually a bug in Yoz that I told one of the Yoz maintainers to possibly fix. It tries to shrink it. I can show you exactly where it happens. I think it happens, okay. I will stop this because it doesn't really matter. This is some case in Yoz that is unhandled. You get back a message that has some crash. And if you go to Yoz server, line 3482, you will see there that there is a funny comment. Let's see this. Deps, Yoz, source, Yoz server, line 3482 or something like that. Ah, it's this amazing comment. Ugh! Yet another crash, user crash, and it gets back this internal error, actually something is not really properly handled in Yoz. Yeah, they will fix it, I hope. The property is correct. So this is so far, this is totally automatic. You just have to write a URI and a file name that you need to generate your property. Tests. I can show you something more where we are. Now, this is the easy part. It generates all this stuff automatically. Oops. The tool, you don't have to write a single line of code, provided you have a valid WSDL specification for your web service. It knows how to handle it, go, read it, generators for it, generate simple response-like properties for it. Now, perhaps you want, of course, what happens here is you just test that your server, your web service, handles all the requests, nothing more. There is no semantics in here. It doesn't really say anything. Now, if you want to do something more than that, if you want to do property-based testing, you need to actually, what has happened here? Has jumped. If you want to do property-based testing, you need to modify this slightly. But the modifications are really simple. You can take all the code that was before. Everything that is in blue and black is the thing that was before and was automatically generated, and you just have to write your property. So the interesting part here for the list delete is what we have written before. There is not a list. If you delete something from a list, the X that you get back is not a member anymore. Now, for reasons that I don't really know, you also have to write this undefined case because sometimes Yoz returns back undefined stuff rather than just the return. I don't know why this happens, but sometimes you don't even get back lists. And now you can test now this property. I will show you this. I have done it before. And I have edited manually this file. And the only difference between what I showed you before is just these red lines. You can believe me on this right now because I don't have enough time to show it by doing it manually. So, oops, let me start it again. From here, there is another file called Customize My Delete. That is like the previous one, but I have added these two lines, these two red lines of code. And now I can do a property-based testing of that, of the property that it, all the X's are removed. And you can see now that my web service that implements this service of deleting elements from a list does not satisfy this property that I was hoping that would satisfy, that my naive implementation of list delete deletes all the elements of the list. So now, after 52 tests, it has found a case where this does not work. It does the shrinking automatically and finds you a minimal test case for which the property does not hold. And you can see that this is not the previous example that I showed you because now I'm using the lists as the first element and the element in the second part. So I think with this tool that will soon be part of Proper, it's not yet, the testing of web services is considerably simplified. Clearly, it's very, very nice that you can do response testing of web services automatically, fully automatically. You don't have to write a single line of code. If you want to do something more complicated than that, you just have to write the properties. Everything else you get automatically. It gets automatically generated. We are also working into testing RESTful services. I don't have anything to report right now on that. We are just working on it. More info will appear soon on our Proper website. If you are interested in this, try to check it out in some days or so.
Okay, thank you very much.